Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the greatest. You see, it is very easy for one to elevate, to praise his hero, his saint, his imam, his prophet. Very easy to idolize our great men. Very easy. And we all have a tendency to do that, whether Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Jew. That whom do you esteem to be the greatest person? So each will give his hero according to his knowledge and experience. I had an occasion to take a Portuguese couple around the mosque in Durban. I happened to be one of the guides to the Juma Masjid Durban, and it attracts a lot of visitors. So we take them around, explain to them what goes on, and we give them free literature. But talking to this Portuguese couple, the Portuguese gentleman, somehow the subject arose, and he was telling me that the greatest man that ever lived was Dr. Salazar. Have you heard of him? Dr. Salazar. Bulk of the people, they never heard the name, Dr. Salazar. But you can't take exception to his claim, because he only knows Dr. Salazar. Can you see? To him, Portuguese gentleman, he must have done great work for his nation. He is the greatest man that ever lived, Dr. Salazar. So it's quite easy for one to idolize one's own hero. But if the tribute, the praise, the testimony comes from the opposite camp, that would be testimony indeed. We praise our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Christian praises Jesus Christ. The Hindu praises Rama and Krishna. It's natural. But if the enemy praises your hero, then that is real praise indeed. You agree? Coming from the enemy. And in that regard, a book has just been published in America. The title of that book is The 100. See this book? Quite an expensive book. The 100. Alternatively described as the top 100 or the greatest 100 in history. The author is a certain Michael H. Hart, described as an astronomer and a mathematician. This American, he goes out of his way to search in history for the 100 most influential men from Adam alayhi salam, from Adam up to current times. And he gives us a list of those 100 most influential men according to his reasoning. He gives reasons behind every person that he chooses. Why he chose this number one, and why he chose that number 30, and why he chose that number 100, he gives you reasons. And the amazing thing about his list is this, that number one on his list, you can guess, is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number one, Muhammad. An American in America, writing a book which retails in America for $12.50, 572 pages. Who will buy his book? The 200 million nominal Christians of America, or the 6 million Jews? Not Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, or Arabs. Oh, they'll buy, one here, one there. But the bulk of his customers will be the Americans. The market is the American market, Christians and Jews. And he's telling them that Muhammad, the member of their opposition, is the first man, the greatest man, most influential man in history. And the shocking thing about his list is this, that his own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is number three. His own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is number three, not even number two. And he gives his reasons for that also. He said, you see, the honor for Christianity, or whatever it is to be divided between Paul and Christ. And he said that the real founder of Christianity is not Jesus Christ, is Saint Paul. He wrote more books. 27 books. 27 different books, out of which more than half, 14 are written by this one man, Paul, Saint Paul, the self-appointed apostle of Jesus. Self-appointed. He didn't go and choose him. He chose 12. But the self-appointed apostle, as he claims, Paul, he wrote 14 out of 27 books, more than half. And everything that the Christian is preaching today is not the preachings of Jesus, are not the teachings of Jesus, are the teachings of Paul. See, whenever we are have an argument with the Christian, we are asking him, do you keep the laws and the commandments? Because Jesus said so. One jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Do you keep the laws and the commandments? He said, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments or shall teach men so shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Do you keep the laws and the commandments? He says, no. So why don't you? So he says, no, the law is nailed to the cross. He said, we are now living under grace. I said, where did you get that? So he says, Corinthians, Philippians, Galatians. So what's all that? Who's that? He says, this is Paul. 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 So what did your master say? No, they don't talk about the master, Jesus. They don't talk about him. Paul. 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 If they contradict you in anything, it's Paul. The real founder of Christianity is Saint Paul. So this man, Michael at heart, he gives the, had it not been, he would have come number two, Jesus Christ. But since the honor is divided, he goes to number three. So I'm asking, please account for it. Why should an American in America publish a book? He wants to do business. And he's provoking his customers. You see, in business, we say that the customer is always right. You must appease your customers. If you want to do business, you must please your customers. You don't argue and debate with your customers, otherwise they won't come back. But this man is telling his customers that they are all wrong. And he's right. Muhammad number one, Jesus Christ number three. Now, if a Christian confirms what Allah Bari Ta'ala has already told us in the Holy Quran, he says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. He says, most certainly thou, O Muhammad, standest on the highest pinnacle of behavior. It makes us happy that a Christian in America, he goes to confirm what the Quran stated 1400 years ago. But the problem is, I say, account for it. We are asking the unbeliever, account for this. Why should he go out of his way and provoke his customers? So some cynic, you know, jocular fellows, sarcasm, they say maybe some Arab might have bribed this fellow. You know, the Arabs are very rich. They have just run into money, petrodollars, you know, petrodollars. It's quite easy for an Arab. You know, one of our brethren, he's married to a woman from Johannesburg, a white woman from Johannesburg. And she boasts about her illegitimate daughter, that woman, the wife of Adnan Khushabji. So our brother Adnan, he was spending $30,000 an hour for his wife to see color TV on her yacht in the Mediterranean. She could have seen black and white, but it wasn't good enough for her. She must see color TV. But with who? With her boyfriend, Rudolf Churchill. And our brother is paying for that. Our brother is paying $30,000 an hour to beam by satellite, especially for his wife to enjoy with her boyfriend in the yacht. Another of our brethren, he goes to the Australian waters to do fishing. Blue marlin, you know, it's that game fish. You might have seen it on TV. When you hook that, it flies out of the water like a bird. And it, you know, it's a fighting fish. So he went to catch blue marlin in the Australian waters. He didn't catch anything, poor fellow. But the people who helped him to bait the hook, he gave them $2,000 each. Tip, $2,000 each. Look, if our brothers can do that, why can't they give $10,000 to Michael H. Hart? He said, look, man, you're writing a book. What about putting in a few good words for my Muhammad? I say it's possible, but it's not probable. It wouldn't enter the minds of our brethren.